graphics stuff.
Graphics stuff, very good. I can see you read the announcement carefully.
All members and friends. Grab the pillow.
I don't know, John.
The less rowdy ones introduce themselves. You are?
I'm Chris, I'm with Harvey.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I recall. And you are?
Ralph Human.
Ralph, hi.
Hi.
I'm Fred.
Howard.
Lindsay.
Harvey.
John. And there's Bill.
I'm Bill.
Okay. We're live.
Yeah.
Are you plugged in and?
We're live. We're rolling.
As I understand it, Fred got the word from Bill Silverman that he wanted a recording. So Fred suggested I also do a screen recording, which you can do with this Cam Studio, which is a free program. And all I know about it is if you hit this record button, it should record what I'm saying into the mic here and also what's going on the screen. So we'll try that.
We learned something else new.
We did? What did we learn?
This.
Oh, I did, yeah.
Now we all learned it.
Well.
We'll see if it explodes.
I just tried it out about, I guess it was last night, for about 5 minutes and it seemed to work. So I'm going to hit this button and now my voice should be being recorded along with the screen. I'm Bill Perkinson. We're going to be talking about On One Photo Raw, which the icon for the program is right here. Just a little bit of background. You may recall, probably not, but I did give a talk on the previous On One graphics program, which is called, it's still available, it's called On One Photo Suite. But that program does not do RAW files at all. So they, I assume, thought there was a reasonably big market, that the RAW files from the newer cameras and such were going to be the way of the future. So they rewrote their whole program from scratch to do editing of RAW files. And I was just talking to the gentleman in the back. He was using Lightroom, but the older versions of Lightroom don't do RAW files either, although I think...
They do all the files, but they do my Nikon files, but they don't do my Sony.
They don't
files.
Do them all. Yeah, right. They don't have a large
Sony
repertoire.
Over. I didn't realize when I put the camera in there, different versions of RAW.
So now you need new software. Yeah. Tough deal. You can't ever stay ahead of the game, I guess. But, and just as a little background about On One, previous to this program we're going to talk about tonight and previous to their one that they had before that, they were known in the industry for making plugins for Photoshop. And they had like 5 or 6 plugins. I think the most famous one was Genuine Fractals. You may have heard of that one. It's a way of upsizing pictures without losing any quality, they say, but as much quality as some of the other algorithms. It's all about the algorithm and how you add on new pixels. And also you can, of course, downsize pictures. And when you have to throw away some pixels, and again, it's the algorithm, how that's done. So there's lots of programs, lots of variations, some better than others. But On One did get a reputation. Their Fractal plugin was very well accepted in the industry. And then they had a number of other plugins and they said, hey, we're missing the boat here. Why don't we just put them all together in a common interface, and we've got all the technology. All we need is the interface, basically. So that's how their graphics programs got started. The Photo Suite, as they first called it. And then now the rewrite in On One Photo Raw. So let's see what this guy looks like. Typically when you first open it, you come into what they call the browser. In Photoshop Elements, I think this is called something else, but the same idea.
Organizer.
Organizer, thank you. Howie is a, he's going to be the expert on Photoshop elements. He's a running 14, he tells me, so that's almost the current one. And Bill Silverman seemed to be very interested in what is the comparison between these two, because they are similar in price. And this one I got, I did a pre-order on this, and it was $79. It included several training videos, which were pretty good. So I got into it fairly early, but of course I really didn't get spending a lot of time on it until recently. And the thing about this, again, now this is the old business model where you buy the program and then they give you free upgrades for a while until they come up with some major new rewrite, then you buy it again. That's how Photoshop used to be. But fairly, you know, a year or so ago, Photoshop changed to what's called the software as a service model, where you pay monthly a much smaller amount, but every month you've got to pay that, or if they find out you didn't pay, the program stops working. That's the software as a service model. A lot of people are going to it. A lot of manufacturers, I hate that model myself. If you're a full-time photographer and that's your livelihood, then that makes a lot of sense. And that's what Photoshop, they saw that as their market. So they said, we're gonna switch over. I read some of the emails that were coming out, people were hating on them, and you know, but it's business is business, so that's what they thought their market was, and apparently it's working fine because they're still in business putting out new updates every so often, and so they're in good shape. Stock hasn't dropped. So Photoshop is still out there. You can get Photoshop and Lightroom for $10 a month currently. And up as long as you want to pay $10 a month, you have access to every update. And they stopped doing updates like every 2 or 3 months, and now the updates are more like could be every week. They just evolve the software and it automatically downloads if you're paying the monthly fee. So that's the advantage. But for On1 Photo Raw, it's not the software as a service. You just buy the program, and they're so far been very good. I just got an update, I think 2 weeks ago, that added new features and solved some bugs and so forth. So that's what you can expect with this program. Howie tells me the same basic thing. He's been running 14. The most current Photoshop elements is 15. And if he wants 15, he'll just have to buy 15, wherever the best price is that he can buy it, and start with 15. So Photoshop, or Adobe's really got both models. Photoshop Elements is not software as a service. It's the old one, but it's not the full Photoshop, of course. Well, and I'll try to make the comparisons I know about. Like I said, this is the, you see over here on the right, can you actually see that, or is it too small? There's these five modules. The browse module is highlighted. That's what we're in now. It's the way you look at your slides on a quick basis and decide which one you want to work on. Then there's a develop module, an effects module, a layers module, and a resize module. And we'll go into some of those pretty, at least enough to see what they are. But let's start with the browse module. You can see over here on the left, there's a group of things you can do. The first one, like it says local drives here. Is that too small?
You can use the screen magnifier.
Yeah, I've got that. It just, okay, let's.
Because there's no way that.
Let's do that.
Magnifiers can read that.
Okay, we'll jump over. You kind of lose the context of where you are, but at least you can see it a lot better.
There's another magnifier that only magnifies.
Yeah, I don't like using that one. It's too complicated for me, but can't keep track of what I'm doing. I can barely keep track of what I'm doing in general, but you can see here it's showing me the C drive, so if you click on the little twirl down, that's all the folders that are under my C drive. And if you can just keep going, there's users. This is my wife's computer, so it's called Michelle. I'm not Michelle, but she lets me use it. So if you open that, then all of the various folders, and you just keep going and going. Here's the pictures folder, and here's a bunch of slides that she took at a camp. She was operating for underprivileged kids. So on and on and on. So you can drill down and look at what's on your computer using that method. D drive, that's just my CD, so that's nothing on that right now. Then there's a group called Cloud Storage. And if you use Dropbox, Google Drive, or OneDrive, they all show up here and you can drill down if you've got stuff stored on them, which I do not. So really, there's no reason to show these. You can go into preferences and elect not to show these and only show the ones that you actually use. So that's how you drill down on the various data that you have on your hard drive. Then you can also organize it, and this is very nice. You can see something up here called indexed folders. And any folder on your hard drive, you can drag over to that. Hello, hello.
Hey, how are you?
Good to see you.
Thank you, you too.
Just throw Fred's stuff off that chair.
Hey, I'm zooming this way. You want to sit back here? Zoom back here.
We can sit over there. We'll just put it
okay.
So we're not in your way.
No problem.
We're talking about On1 Photo Raw. And we're just into the browser where you look at your pictures as a thumbnail. So these index folders, though, if you drag any folder on your hard drive in here and drop them right into this place right here, it will add them to what's called the index folder. All that means is it doesn't use up hardly any extra space. It doesn't duplicate the pictures. It just puts a mark and lets you go to those pictures and see them as kind of like a marker. So you can put folders in here and not take up any real extra space on your hard drive, no matter what. But if, say, I would add a picture, I get a new picture and I want to put it in this folder, if that folder is indexed, it will show up in that folder over here as well. And what I'm showing right now is this one called 2014 slides. So if I would click on that, that's the index folder and it's shown over here. If I click on this one, then it's showing me the photos that are in that folder. So it's an easy, quick way to get to the folders that you use for your pictures most of the time. But as I showed, anytime you can go anywhere on the C drive down here and find any picture, no matter where you put it, even if you didn't decide to index it. But what I did was index the three folders I thought I might end up using somehow tonight. But even better then is your filters. Let's just scroll down over here. And they provide three different ways to mark your photographs. And this is very similar to Photoshop Elements as well. Let's drive down. Anything marked with one of these little folders like this is a folder. The actual pictures show up with no mark on them. So you always know, am I looking at a folder or am I looking at an actual picture? And you see these little markings along the top of each picture in the browser? Let's say what I actually did, I went through all the pictures that I thought I might use and marked them as a red picture, meaning for tonight, red means a picture I might want to look at tonight, quickly, easily. So you click on this color, and you can either mark it as red, yellow, green, blue, or purple. This one's marked as blue, so I wasn't planning on using that tonight. But this one over here is marked as red. That means if we get to it, I'll maybe look at that one. There's a couple of other red ones in this folder. So I've got two red marked folders there. Then you can mark them as, how great is this picture? You can make up your own meanings for these, obviously, but stars typically mean, yeah, this is a two-star picture. Or, man, this one's really good. I like it. It's a five-star. There's that six, five. Then there's a heart over here. You can like a picture and sort on all the pictures you marked as I love this picture. So there's three different ways to get to your pictures, and just let me show you how that works. You go over here into the filter section, and you say, okay, let's activate that. So you activate filters, and then if I want to see all the pictures that I marked to use tonight, I would say, let me see those red pictures, and then I'll go down here and search, and it only searches on folders that are indexed, but all of my red photos are in the index filter, so I'll click that, and boom. Let me go back a little less there, just so you can see. That popped up all the pictures I went through and selected red. So these are the pictures I'll be using tonight. And one thing you might notice, well, let me just back up again. That's the trouble with the, there's an information panel here. So when you click on a picture, say I click on this one, you can see the information for that picture popped up. And it's showing me all the metadata that maybe is associated with that picture. In this case, the author. I got this picture from Nicole S. Young, who does some of the training for online software that I had downloaded. She gives you the pictures to go along with the training, which is great. And it's also telling me over here, this is color space is Adobe RGB, and was 326 by 4,896 pixels at 300 pixels per inch, and the size of it. And so you can see, this is a PSD file right here in the name. Some of these are RAW files. There's a RAW file. That one is 16 megabytes, a little bit over. And you may not have even been aware, but when I opened the browser, those RAW files open instantaneously. I mean, this is an i5 processor, not a huge processor. It does have 12 megabytes of RAM, but it's not an extremely powerful machine, but these RAW files open instantly. I was pretty impressed with that.
Is there a default, like a scratch disk, like in Photoshop, Photo Elements?
What no,
they call scratch disk?
There's no scratch disk per se. They don't make, with Photoshop Elements and Photoshop CC and Lightroom makes an actual copy of the, and renders the thing before they can display it. This works differently. It just reads the picture information and puts it up there. There's no storing, there's no catalog, no scratch disk. So that's why, one reason it's so fast. And again, they wrote it for this very purpose. They seem to think that one of the big drawbacks of other products on the market was getting into the RAW file market. There's so much data associated with them that they're too slow. Now, when you have to render it, you'll see there can be delays in putting on some of the changes and so forth when you actually have to render the picture. But just opening a RAW file, think of it as instant. You won't even see a delay. I think an i3 processor could even do it. So that's good. So that's the browse module. You probably can't tell. Let me go back to magnifier again. Just just look at this one picture a little easier. Also, you can do some quick operations in the browse module, like this one is rotated wrong. So I can rotate left with this arrow, and again, bang. I mean, there's no delay because that's not really rendering anything. It's not changing anything. It's just doing it. But I'll put it back to the way it was naturally. So that's pretty much what you can do with the browser. There are some other things. Under search, you can also type in words here. And if you had a keyword associated with that picture, it'll find it. Or any descriptive information you can search on. So that's a good way of doing it. And it also has this recent panel down here. Looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, excuse me, about the last 8 pictures that you have done something to. It'll show them here so you can go back to them easily. All right, so let's just look again at these modules over here, because typically the workflow is what you do is you select a picture from the browser that you want to work on, and then you pick which module do I want to go into to change it or to make it better, hopefully. And so one of the learning things about this program is, and they all have a learning curve, obviously, at least that's been my experience, what does each module do? You've got to kind of have that in your mind so you're not searching around going back and forth to the different modules. And I thought it was a pain at first, and it only took me like a week to kind of get the hang of it. Develop is like Lightroom. You'll see it changes basic things like the exposure, saturation, the contrast, things like kind of overall type things. The effects is where you put on what you would think of as if you were taking a picture with a camera, would you be screwing a filter onto the front of the lens to polarize it or make it black and white or to highlight skies or those, that's what you do in effects. And by the way, like all programs that I've used along this line, if you got to start with a reasonably good picture. If you're trying to work on something that's so out of kilter that, you know, you might as well not. But you can make a good picture much better. A well-taken shot, and you can then change it in effects to put on different looks and kind of good photographers, I guess, they want to have a look. What's their look? Can you see a picture and, oh, I bet that's from this guy. That's how you get famous as a photographer. So that's what this effects is. Layers is where you do work like replacing skies, where you need multiple layers, where you do compositing, where you want to blend multiple photographs into one, that sort of thing. So that's fairly straightforward. Hopefully we'll demo that. And resize is just where you use that good old Genuine Fractals technology that they invented to make pictures bigger or smaller. And you can do some other tricks with it, like if you want to wrap a picture around a coffee cup when it's printed out, you can kind of do that. And also you can break a picture. Say you want to make a huge poster on the wall, so you've got a picture here and you can break it up into maybe 6 different photographs and print out each one separately and then paste them together on the wall, 6 or 9 or 2, lay them out that way. So that's what resize does. So, all right, let's go into one of these modules. Good one to, one other thing I wanted to mention. The first 3 modules will work on raw files directly. This browse module, obviously. develop where you change the basic structures of the pictures. It can do that. It can do a raw file edit directly, and effects. You can put filters on the front of the picture directly, even if it's a raw file. But if you go into layers, interestingly, raw files don't support layers. They just don't. They're not built for layers. Raw files are one layer. It's the picture you get. It's hugely detailed and it's got a lot of information, but it's not made for layers. So when you go into the layers module, that's where you have to, if it's a raw file that you want to go into layers with, it converts it to a Photoshop file, or actually one of several formats that you set up in preferences. I've got mine set to convert to PSD. In other words, you got to convert it to a format that does support layers. You can't do layers in RAW. It's not a limitation of the program, it's just that's the way RAW files are. So these, and the same thing with the resize. You need to convert whatever photograph, if it's not already a JPEG or a PSD already, then if it's a RAW file, it'll convert it automatically. So let's, I guess what, one thing would be nice, let's look at this one. This one is a DNG.
Excuse me, Bill.
Yes. Yeah, please interrupt anytime.
I've heard that you should keep your pictures in RAW for resizing to expand them, but you're just saying that if you have RAW, you should convert it to JPEG and then resize. Have I got something wrong?
No. I think the rule, if you photograph something in RAW, that's, you ought to save that. You ought to always have that and not lose it, because it's got the most detail that you can possibly have in today's technology. All the other formats, other than a different RAW file, there's different, as you found out, each camera has their own version of RAW, but like this one is a NEF and this one is a DNG. Both are RAW, but yes, keep your RAW files. But some things that you want to do, say to print them out at a different size, you do need to convert them and then work on that photograph. But keep that RAW, don't lose it.
Is there a better, which do you convert to when you want to print? I mean, JPEG, or which is better to print out of, what doesn't matter?
Well, I would go to another lossless program format, like TIFF or PSD, because JPEG, you always lose something. And then if you work on it and you save it, and then you decide, oh gee, I want to work on it again, you lose even more. And then if you save that and you decide to work on it again, you lose even more, and it gets worse and worse and worse. That's the problem with JPEG. The advantage with JPEG is that almost every program in the world can read it, and it's very highly compressed. So the file size gets a lot smaller.
JPEG is a standard, right?
It is standard.
Right, the other ones are standards also?
TIFF is standard, PNG is standard, PSD is standard. Photoshop, when they had the market just about to themselves, whatever formats they came out with kind of became the standards. And that was the PSD.
What does PSD stand for?
Photoshop something. I can't remember.
Everyone said you there, that's perfect.
Yes.
But if you take it to a professional lab, their stuff will read that stuff.
I don't know. Does anybody use the labs enough? Maybe you can send a RAW file to a print lab and they'll print it. But my guess would be, if that's the case, they're going to convert it to something that's more conducive to printing. But, you know, again, if you've got the RAW file, you're always good to go. You can use that and then work down from there. So I'll show you how that works. This is a RAW file, and I'm going to take it into develop. So develop can edit RAW directly, so there shouldn't be any conversion. So I clicked clicked on the develop module, and let me back off of the magnifier again a little bit, just so you can see the whole context here. And what would you say is the problem with this photograph as photographed? This is still the raw photograph as photographed. No changes have been applied. Sky's overexposed, right? Yeah, way overexposed. Pardon?
Overexposed.
Yeah, overexposed. The sky here is definitely overexposed. The rocks in the foreground aren't too bad. And the water is actually a little overexposed as well.
I just have one question.
Yeah.
Is there a minimum file size for a photo where if it gets below it, it's not really worth working with? You know what I'm saying?
That's a great question. Is there any minimal file size for photographs? And I've never seen it written down, but my experience is if it's less than a megabyte, it's going to be pretty much garbage, and it's going to be very difficult to operate any of these kind of editing programs on it. And that's why any raw photograph you'll see, I've never seen one less than 15 megabytes. And of course, some other PSD files even go, I think one of these in here is 120 megabytes. If the file size is so small that the detail isn't there, you're not going to be able to really work with it. But again, with raw files, there's a lot of detail that isn't visible. And that's where these kind of programs, for example, the exposure. Just look at the sky when I move this slider. If I move it down, you see the detail coming out of that? I mean, it's there, obviously, and it's in the raw format, it's in the data, but it's just as taken, it wasn't very well exposed. But as you can see, when I moved the exposure of the sky down, now the rocks are too dark. So, get the rocks where they should be, now the sky is really blown out. There's no detail whatsoever there. And another way to see that, you can see some tabs up here, or hopefully you can. This is called the navigation tab because it's showing you when you zoom in, there's a little square that you can move around. But let's see, it says show the histogram. You can see the brights are all jammed up against the right here. That's a sign that your whites are overexposed. You're clipping the whites. They're all jammed up. Ideally, you would have what's called a bell-shaped curve right here in the middle, and everything would be perfect. Well, nothing's ever perfect in the real world when you take pictures. So, but watch this, the right part of these brights when I move the exposure down. Can you see where it's starting to unclip? Up there, it's completely unclipped. Right in there, that's your sweet spot. Just before, as soon as you clip, you know you're throwing data away. That's the meaning of clipping. You've gone beyond the range of what the camera can do. And so you want to keep these. Now, if you can get that, so we're unclipped, but you know, I think most people just move the slider until the picture looks good. If we move the, there's one that's called blacks, that should affect the left-hand side of things. See, if I go too far down, the blacks are clipping now, so I'll move them up. And so you can kind of use that visual guide, which comes in handy, or again, I think most people just look at the picture and say, when does it look good to me? And just the last tab, by the way, if you want to look at your photo information while you're in the develop module, this is how you do it. You go to the info tab, but let me go back to navigation and show you up here, can you see that? What, this one says fit, that means fit the picture into the screen. But a lot of times it's recommended for some improvements on the picture, you want to be at 100, what's called 100%. This is where you're looking at 100% view, the full pixel. And so when you're in that view, of course, you want to be able to scroll around a little bit. And if you press the space bar, that gives you this little hand. And now when I'm zoomed in, I can still move around in the picture. I can't ever remember keyboard shortcuts. I'm terrible at it. But there's some. I finally remembered in this picture, and space bar is one of them, because when you zoom in, you want to be able to move the picture around. So that's one I've managed to remember. I use it all the time. So space bar, move around when you're zoomed in.
Now in this program, can you select just the sky? Do you have any selection tools?
Oh, there's all kind of selection tools.
Okay.
Let's go back to fit. So now we're looking at the whole thing. And the point I was about to make, that's a great question at this time. You want to make one adjustment to the sky, but that throws the rocks off. So you'd like to be able to adjust the sky and the rocks separately. So how in the world would you do that? And by the way, just with this, all of this with on one, after you make an adjustment, if you want to go back to the default setting, you double click that slider. So double click exposure, and it goes right back to the middle. So it's just an easy way to get back to where you started. Or if you want to reset all the sliders, you hit the reset all, and that resets every slider back to the default. So it's easy to get back where you started.
And when you make these adjustments, is it on the actual picture, or is it making a copy of the original?
Great question. I'm not sure the questions are being picked up, so I'll try to repeat them. Are the adjustments destructive, is basically the question.
Right.
In this program, if you're working on the first three modules, it's 100% non-destructive. Never ever will it get you into a position where you have messed up the only copy of the picture that you have. So that's good. They're very, rightfully proud of that, I think. Non-destructive editing, that's what this is called.
That's a good answer.
Yeah.
Good question, good answer.
Yeah, it's the answer you want. But let's go over, there's another tab here. This is called Overall Settings. There's one called Local Adjustments. And you notice this pane over here changed a little bit. You don't have quite the same number of sliders as you do if you're in overall settings. It's like the temperature and the tint, vibrance, the purity, I think disappeared. But with local adjustments, you can operate on whatever part of the picture you would like. And what this is doing, of course, is putting a mask on. So you can, let's look over here. See this button? That's called an adjustment brush. And as soon as you went to the local adjustments, that brush is selected, and that's what's making this up here. Now, this brush has properties. You can see right now it's at size. Maybe you can't see. Let me magnify again. Size 400, no feather. So say if I went to a little feather. There is a feather 29. See how the cursor changed? It's got dots around the outside. The solid circle is where the mask is going to be solid. Then it's going to feather out to no mask at the edge of the dotted lines. So that's the feather, and you can see if you move that feather slider up a lot higher, that's good. now the distance between the solid in the middle and the dotted is bigger. That means it's a bigger feather than it was before. But for this kind of stuff, I like to work at about 20, somewhere in there. That's a pretty good feather. So the other thing to notice is the mode. You can either paint in or you can paint out. And what that means is I'm going to paint in the effect or I'm going to paint it out. And if you're trying to adjust the sky right now, let me go back to, okay, it's fit. Let me just back off of the magnifier for a minute just to get the context. So what I want to do is I want to mask the sky. So, and I want to paint in the effect, and it's good to say just move one of these sliders. If it's at zero, you won't see anything happen. But if I move this exposure way up, now it's not changing the picture now, but it will when I put this mask on. So if I paint it in, see how it overexposing the sky now? So what I'm doing is painting a mask on here. And let me just stop there. How can I see what I'm doing with this mask? Well, there's a little button down here. It's called the show hide the mask view. So I click on that. Now, that should be something you recognize if you've worked with masks before. Because when you reveal the effect or you paint in the effect, that's going to be white. Every place where the effect is not going to be shown is going to be black. So these masks are going to be black and they're going to be white. This program has a nice little trick here. If you go under masks, there's several ways you can view it. Well, really only two. This is the grayscale, so-called, we're looking at now. Or you can look at a red overlay. Now, you can see the picture under where you're not putting the effect on. So this is black, but up here, wherever I put white, I'm gonna paint the effect in. So this takes a little getting used to, but again, it turns out this red overlay thing is very nice because I like being able to see what I'm not changing kind of underneath there. The problem now is though, I'm taking my mask, I want to only get the sky, which is obviously stuff above the horizon. What if I slip, which I always do, and I go, oop, oh, okay. Now I've painted in that exposure setting into the place I don't want it. So another keyboard shortcut that I do remember, Control Z. I think it's the same in Photoshop. Control Z means undo.
It's the same word also.
Yeah, that's right. So that's pretty common. I guess that's why I don't have any trouble remembering it. So I'm going to Control Z that. Control Z, pretty quick. Well, let's go back to the not mask view. Just click that again. So I know I don't want to dip down into the part that I don't want to do here while I'm doing this masking. But what's the on-one solution to that? I've got the adjustment brush clicked, so that's why I'm unmasking. But there's variations. If you go up here to the, so you can see that a little better. See that little symbol there? It's a brush with a sparkle by it. That's called the magic brush. No, I'm sorry, that's a different program. This is called the Perfect Brush in On1. And right now it's gray, so it's not selected, but if I click that, now it's blue, and it comes up with this little explanation of what is this all about. let me just read it quickly. The Perfect Brush automatically detects and protects edges. As you brush, it samples the colors under the center of the brush and only affects those colors. And why is that useful? Well, we'll see in a minute, I think. And you can toggle it on with a Control R, but I'll never remember that, so I'll always be clicking it up here. But the one thing that you do have to remember is the key, the control key, locks the sampled color until you release it. So even with the Perfect Brush, there's kind of two modes. Let me show you exactly what that is. And so that doesn't pop up every time. You can say, don't show this again, but you can always bring it back under help. But I'm not going to have that pop up every time, so I'm going to close it. Now when I click it on and off, I won't get that same dialogue. Let's make another keyboard shortcut. I do remember the bracket keys to make brushes bigger and smaller. Let's make a nice big brush here. And the way the Perfect Brush works, remember it samples the color under the center of the brush, and the center of the brush is that plus sign. You can see the plus sign there. So if I click here, left click, it will remember the color that's under the brush. And so when I move down now, see, even though I go over the skylight there, I'm a little over it, but it's only affecting colors that are under the plus sign. So I'm getting a mask, even though I'm being very loose, it's still masking what I want. Let's go down here and look at the mask view just to see what I did. See over here where I was working? It didn't, even though I was hanging over the edge, it kept remembering the color up here. So I can see now I gotta do a little more here. So I'll just click there and get the, even if the shade of the color changes, it'll change. So see down here again, see what's happening? As long as that center is above the sky of the horizon there, I'm okay. But what happens if I'm really nervous and if I go down here? What do you think will happen if I click there? It'll pick up the color of what I don't want, and it'll put some of that in there.
It's like the healing brush.
Yeah. So Control Z on that. Now let's go back to not mask view. One other trick on the Perfect Brush, it talked about it there. If I hold the control key down while I click, then it will remember the last color I was on no matter where I drag the brush. So I'm going to do that now. One suggestion I would have is that brush ought to change somehow when I hold the control key, but it doesn't. Just trust me. Press the control key down now. Now I'm going to click here, and now it'll remember the color where I am right now. So even if I go down here, it doesn't ruin anything because it's remembering the color up here. It's only changing that color. So I can go clear over here. Now I may want to release and start a little closer, so in case that color's changed. But still, it doesn't matter as long as I don't have any sky blue down here. It won't change anything where I don't want to change. So, in a perfect world now, I would have a black and white mask that's exactly where I want it. So let's look at the mask again. And this time I'm going to go to the mask view that's the black and white view. View mode, grayscale. Okay, so now you can see I still got some masking problems. There's a little stuff creeping through here. This ought to be pure black and pure white. So how do I get pure black? I would go back up to my masking brush, turn it off, I mean my perfect brush. Now I'm just masking and I want to paint out. So that should always paint in black. And there I am. So I can fill in, whoops, control Z, I went a little too far.
That's my next question.
What's that?
What happens if you go beyond the...
Yeah, same, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
So I could use the perfect brush here and just turn that on. Now I won't get into the sky accidentally. As long as I'm... I did get into the sky a little bit. But I'm black there. Now I want to go back and paint out again. And typically, I mean paint in again. So if you're a perfectionist, this is how you perfect your masks. And let me turn off the mask view again and see what have we done. Well, now we've got a mask and we're in local adjustments. So now when I mess with this exposure, it should only affect the sky. That's what we want. And we can change the highlights. I mean, we can make the sky even better. Highlight slider, shadow slider. Not too many shadows in the clouds, but you can bring them up or down. Add detail. Too much detail there. And temperature. If you don't like the color temperature of the sky, you can change that a little bit. Whatever looks good to you. A little warmer.
Bill, what was your learning curve? How long did it take you to master that technique?
I've probably been the last week, 2 weeks.
Week? 2 weeks?
Yeah, yeah, it doesn't take long.
That's good.
Well, if you kind of got the idea what it is, what's going on, once you kind of get it, then the details aren't too hard. And if, you know, here's the saturation of the clouds, color saturation. And a nice thing too is if you want to see what you've done, you can go to here and turn the preview on. That's the original photograph. That's where we started. That's the unchanged raw file. And then let's go back to what we did. Put it back on again so you can see how you like it. Now, if I was a perfectionist, I would want to do this again for the rocks. I think we want to move along here, but the way you do that is you just add another one. Now you've got an adjustment layer and you can paint in on the rocks and you can change them with this panel. And then if you want to see each adjustment on and off, there's these little check boxes. Here's the sky button, so I can turn that off, turn it back on again. If I had painted the rocks, I didn't really do anything here, but you can turn that on and off. Yes?
Is it something in what you did to put the pink around that cloud?
It was there. That was detail that you didn't see, but the camera took it and recorded it in the raw file. That's the interesting thing about raw files. They've got tremendous detail. That's why this program works here. If I had done the same kind of thing with a JPEG, I probably wouldn't have seen anything
like
that.
Yeah, but I mean, I think it was there, but it was only when you basically corrected the exposure that you saw that.
Exactly. I mean, in other words, it was there in the sky when the person that took the picture was looking at it, but the camera can't take in everything at once, or it can't display everything at once, but it puts the detail in the raw file. That's how I understand it.
That's why you're better off shooting raw than JPEG, because JPEG you can't correct anything.
You can make some corrections, but this
camera,
raw deal.
The camera does most of the stuff in JPEG.
That's why raw has taken over the world. I don't even have a camera, so I don't take pictures in raw or JPEG or anything else. But I get lots of pictures from different sources and people, and raw has taken over. I mean. There's no DSL out today that doesn't shoot raw, I don't think.
Your cell phone does raw.
Yeah, it's amazing. So Shoot and RAW when you can. The files are bigger, but not necessarily bigger than a PSD file.
My new camera shoots 85 megs for each RAW file.
There you go, 85 megs. Yeah. So that's the trade-off. I mean, depends on what you're going to do, really.
Memory is cheap.
The storage gets cheaper and cheaper, but the files keep getting bigger and bigger. What the next technology will do, I've seen articles about cameras that capture everything. They don't even have a lens. They don't focus anything. They just capture light. And then you do everything afterwards. You do the focusing, the exposure, everything. Well, RAW is kind of the march toward that next kind of thing that's going on.